Hello, Ostrava. The music you're about to hear is made of the waveforms you're about to see. Played back on an oscilloscope. One of these.
To Mark Looney.
Hey. Okay, so rock guitar. Eddie Van Halen there from a song called Hot for Teacher. So, hello, my name is Dr. Looney. That is my real name, okay? In English, that does sound a bit crazy. So, in English, if you're born with that surname, you have to do a PhD, right? It's kind of rude not to, right? So, my PhD is in guitar acoustics, which I'll tell you a little bit about. Basically, how come when I hear a... I just can't get no. What is it about this stuff, this equipment, that causes that revolutionary, history-changing sound? And then later on, it's going to get a bit weird, okay? A bit kind of a... we'll do some weird physics that you probably haven't encountered before. So, first of all... music is all about sound. Sound is all about vibration. What I'm doing right now is I'm shaking the air around at different rates, different frequencies, in order to talk. Everyone just press between your collarbones, just there, just press between your collarbones, and make some kind of sound, like, it doesn't literally need to be, it can be any sound you like, really. Just, so you can feel there's a strong vibration exactly there, okay? They're called your vocal cords. I don't know why, because they're not cords. The little fleshy flaps. When you blow air over a little fleshy flap, it makes a sound, the frequency of which depends on its size. So a tiny little plastic flap like this, I blow air over that, and I get... get a really high frequency kind of monkey noise, which is why babies have got such a cute little high voice. It's really tiny. Then as you get older, it gets bigger, your voice gets deeper, which is why teenage boys sound weird. They do, don't they? I mean, hi, but what's for dinner? It's because the flap is growing faster than they can learn how to control, okay? That's also why they're a bit clumsy. Their limbs are growing faster than they can learn how to control. And that also applies to other parts of the body as well. Above the little flap, I've got a tube of air in my neck. Obviously, it's not that long, okay? If it was that long, I'd be talking out my, never mind. But a tube of air has its own resonances. Oh, I'm gone. And they're the frequencies from the little flap that get emphasized or accentuated. And then finally, from the top of the tube, this equipment here, my teeth and tongue and lips, that shapes or filters the sound from the tube to do this thing called talking. Maybe it's because we humans have got such incredibly good control over this stuff that we could create the entire range of sounds and therefore language and therefore civilization, whereas chimps, maybe even Neanderthal man, all they could manage was the odd Oasis song. So I'm shaking the air around at different rates. If you try and shake the air around too fast, what happens is the air kind of can't move out the way of itself in time, and you get a shockwave or sonic boom. Would you like to hear a sonic boom? Yes, that's better. A bit more enthusiasm would be brilliant. So this is my sonic boom equipment. Very popular with teachers. I'm going to just create one over here. So that's, you can hear it. It's actually, it's a really dead room. So I'm going to listen to the difference outside in the cold. Just have a listen to this. That sounds a lot better, don't you think? And then I'll try it on that side just for the people over here. Okay. Are we ready? We ready to wait? Oh, sorry. Really sorry about that. So, is there a doctor? Yeah. So what I'm doing here is I'm sending a kink along the whip. Yes, a kink. I actually bought this in a really dodgy shop in Wales, right? The guy said, what do you do with this? Oh, I take it into schools. You take it into school? So I'm sending a kink along the whip. You'll notice it gets thinner along its length. That means the kink travels faster and faster until at this tiny little stringy bit at the end, it's going about 1,000 kilometers an hour, the speed of sound. The air can't move that fast, so you get a shockwave or sonic boom. I can actually show you a photo of a sonic boom just as it's happening. Hang on. Sorry, these are some slides from another talk I've just got to get past quickly. It's kind of somewhere here. Oh, yes, right, there you go. So there's a fighter plane, just as it breaks the sound barrier. Now, you can't see the shockwave. That's an invisible high-pressure region around the edge. What you can see is the low-pressure region it leaves behind. Just like on the weather forecast, low-pressure air can't hold as much water vapor, so it condenses into little droplets that we call a cloud. In this case, a perfectly spherical cloud. Pretty cool, don't you think? You can also see another one near the pilot, who's probably a bit freaked out, actually, because if you go faster than the speed of sound, you can actually hear messages from the future. I'm joking. I just say that so people look at each other and go, can you? Yeah. So that's what sound is generally about, moving the air around. It's not just air that can vibrate. Water can carry a vibration as well. The mating song of the blue whale can travel hundreds of miles underwater. In fact, before ship engines came along, two whales might have been able to hear each other almost anywhere in the world. It's so much louder than a jet engine. It's like comparing a jet engine to someone shouting. So, air can vibrate, water can vibrate, solids can vibrate as well. An earthquake could be said to be the sound of heavy rock. The vibrations of a bridge or a building could be said to be the sound of heavy metal. And I'm going to show you how all these different vibrations follow the same simple maths, right? Maths of sine waves. And if you understand that, you can understand almost anything, possibly everything. You're not very easily impressed, are you? That's how you could understand everything. Oh, whatever. Okay, so let's get back to the sound of rock guitar. To understand the sound of rock guitar, first you've got to look at the string. And I'd like you to think of a string as kind of like a stretched out spring. Now, the frequency of the simple side-to-side vibrations of a string or a stretched spring, what's called the fundamental frequency, depends on three things. Firstly, the length. The shorter, the higher. When I put my finger on a fret, I shorten the length of the string, so the frequency rises. Secondly, tension. The looser, the lower. When I press down my whammy bar, I decrease the tension in the string, so the frequency drops. And finally, thickness. All of these strings are the same length and the same tension. It's just the lower pitched ones are thicker. And to get really low notes, they've got to be really thick, which curiously also applies to bassists. Apologies, that's a British joke. Doesn't travel well, okay? So here's the string in its fundamental pattern of vibration. We call it its fundamental mode. That's going about once a second or 1 hertz. A guitar string might be going 100 times a second, but still with that same pattern. But that's not the only pattern. There's not just 100 hertz coming off the string. There's loads of higher frequency components as well. Where do they come from? They come from the harmonics of the string. So imagine this was at 100 hertz. I know it's not there, just pretend it was a lot faster. At the same time, when I pluck a string, it also vibrates in this pattern at 200 hertz. That's called the first harmonic, right? And at the same time, it's vibrating in that pattern at 300 hertz, and 400 hertz, and 500, 600, 700, 800, all the way up to human hearing range. Anyone know what human hearing range is in hertz? Any guesses? 20,000, well, yeah, maybe for you. I've been in a band. Mine's more like 15. So all of these patterns of vibration, 100, 200, 300, 400, all the way up to 20,000 hertz. When I pluck a string, I excite them all, but I hear one note, right? So that one note is actually loads of different frequencies at once. The pitch of the note you think it is this one. And then the tone, the kind of sound, the timbre of the note, depends on this combination of higher frequency components, okay? So if I rest my finger halfway along the string, so it vibrates either side of my finger, at twice the fundamental frequency, I hear the first harmonic. Fundamental, first harmonic. If I rest my finger closer to the end of the string, a third of the way along, I hear the harmonic of the second kind. Closer again, I encounter the third kind. And further, so the next. Next, 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 next. That's about as hard as I go, as far as I go. So when I pluck a string, I excite all of those different patterns of vibration at once. The reason it sounds nice is because there's a nice mathematical relationship between those frequencies. So that's why strings sound nice. Trouble with strings is they're very quiet on their own. If I just turn off a minute. If I turn my volume down and just play the strings alone, you can hardly hear anything. That's because sound is about moving the air around, and a thin little wire doesn't do that very well at all. Now, in a classical or an acoustic guitar, in a classical or an acoustic guitar, what happens is the string transfers its vibration to a thin wooden plate, that thing with the hole in, that moves more air around and makes the string louder. It's a bit like this little music box. You seen one of these little bars that get flicked by the spikes on a barrel as you turn it round, right? Now, because it's very small, it's not moving much air, you probably can't hear what song that is. Huh? That's not moving much air around. This is cool. If I put it on the table, isn't that cool? Right, I haven't got a microphone under there or anything. I'm not cheating. All that's happening, these little vibrations are being transferred to something with a bigger surface area that can move more air around and makes it louder. And that's how all stringed instruments work. Guitars, violins, cellos, pianos, everything. We can actually see the vibrations of a classical guitar if we take a hologram of it. Anyone who can tell me what a hologram is? What's a hologram? You've all seen a hologram, haven't you? Well, how would you describe what it was? A 3D picture, yes. These are pictures as well, they're projections, but they're flat, they're 2D. A hologram's got depth as well, it's another dimension, right? So a hologram takes three dimensions worth of information and stores it on a two-dimensional surface. Just remember that for later. If we take a hologram of a guitar as it's vibrating, we can actually see the different patterns of vibration. So that's a guitar moving kind of like this. That's one moving kind of like this. And so this was my PhD research at Cardiff University, which I won't bore you with because scientists talking about their own research tend to disappear of themselves like a Klein bottle. Or if you understood how all of these different vibrations fitted together, in physics we say how the vibrations are coupled together, we could build better guitars. So they're lovely pictures, aren't they? So that was an acoustic guitar. Let's get back to rock guitar. In an electric guitar, we don't want the string to vibrate a thin wooden plate. That's a solid block of wood. We don't want it to vibrate at all. Instead, what happens is, okay, you remember the harmonics of the string, yeah? The string is vibrating in different patterns at different frequencies at once. What are the strings made of? Metal. They're made of steel. These little circles here are magnets, and there's loads of wires wrapped around the magnets. What you get when you move metal near a magnet with wires wrapped around? Current. You induce an electrical current, Faraday's laws of induction. So remember those harmonics of the metal string? Each of those will induce a sine wavy electrical signal of a certain frequency in the wires wrapped around the magnets that comes out the lead of the guitar, right? Trouble with those signals is they're very weak. What has to happen is they're sent to an amplifier. The amplifier takes alternating current from the mains, turns it into direct current, AC/DC and uses that current to boost these incredibly weak signals. And the trouble with that is they're very fragile. It's very difficult to keep that nice sine wavy shape as we boost the depth, the amplitude of the signal. Guitarists in the 1960s started turning the volume up past the limits of the amplifier. Oh yes, up to 11. And that started squashing the top of the sine waves, made them more like square waves. And you know what? The squashed waves sounded cool. That squashed top gave each harmonic harmonics of its own. Those false electronic harmonics started getting their own false electronic harmonics until eventually plucking the string caused a huge, rich cascade of new frequencies. That cascade of harmonics turned the simplest riff into something powerful. You could get great results without requiring great expertise. Yeah, thanks very much. Add to that the fact that it's so economically cheap just to put some wood and magnets together so anyone can afford it, and bullseye. You got the sound of a revolution. So what else? What else might the physics of guitar strings possibly have any relevance to? What about everything? Everything? Everything. String theory. The theory that all the particles in the universe are the different vibrations of the same tiny strings. Strings so tiny that comparing them to the size of an atom is like comparing a guitar string to the entire universe. It could be that the universe is made of music. Or it could be a complete load of bollocks. I don't know. Only a few thousand people in the world really understand string theory properly. I'm not one of them. And there's no definitive evidence for or against it yet. There might never be. But it's an interesting candidate for a theory of everything, a theory of your existence. So it's worth at least hearing what it's about. Remember the harmonics of the string, okay? Those different patterns of vibration. Now imagine the string wasn't fixed at the end, like a guitar string, but you could flap around, or you could join them in a loop, but it still had the same patterns, the same harmonics. String theory says that all of the particles in the universe, from the quarks that make the atoms that me and you are made of, to the electrons that form the electricity in my amps, to the photons of light coming off the lights, and even the graviton, the particle that carries the force of gravity. String theory says that all of these different particles are the different harmonics of the same tiny strings, superstrings, whose tension, 10 to the 39 tons of tension, that's one with 39 zeros after it, tons of tension, more stress than watching Fox News, shrinks those strings so small we'd be forgiven for thinking they were just points. And it gets even weirder. What if these particles are the vibrations of tiny strings, but only the vibrations we can see in our three dimensions, while a string's existing and vibrating more than three? What if our universe, like the three dimensions of our universe, like a hologram, holds the information from more? What am I talking about? More than three dimensions. We get by fine with just three, don't we? Left, right, front, back, up, down. What are you going to call the other one? So I'll try with a diagram, right? There's a point. Zero-dimensional object. It has no length or depth or height. There's a line, one dimension. It's got length only, but still no depth or height. Rectangle, two dimensions. It's got length and height, but still no depth. Cuboid, this is more like the hologram. It's got length and height and depth. You can imagine it rotating in three dimensions, yeah? Hypercube, it's got length and height and depth and air. And one of them rotating looks like that. Now, I don't know about you, but that makes my eyes sick. What the hell is going on there? String theory gets even worse by saying that the tiny dimensions might be rolled up inside the big three in shapes called Calabi-Yau manifolds. I don't even know what that represents, okay? I think you had to have had acid on your cornflakes since childhood to understand maths like that. But string theory says that if the space was shaped like that, the vibrations of the tiny strings would look like our familiar particles, right? So there's an introduction to string theory. The trouble with string theory is it's not properly testable yet. To be properly science, you've got to have an experiment that will give two sets of results. At least, that both of which seem realistic. One of which you go, right, that's my set. The other one, if that turns out, you go, right, that set means I'm wrong, which is very difficult to do. I can turn you all into scientists straight away, right, by saying four words. You ready? I. Might. Be. Wrong. All together.
I might.
Congratulations, you are now all scientists. You have explicitly admitted the possibility of error. You don't hear that very often, do you? In other fields of human endeavor. Like politics? No. Religion? Not really. Science is kind of unique in requiring you to say, right, I'm the easiest person to fool with my own ideas. Because I just I confirm everything that confirms them, and I just ignore. No, just shut up. Science requires you to open your eyes and say, I'm going to let the universe decide whether I'm an idiot or not, and actually admit it. It's very difficult to do, right? So string theory isn't testable, but this idea of turning matter into maths, that's called quantum physics. And that has withstood the harshest tests the cleverest people in the world have come up with for over 100 years, especially those at the Large Hadron Collider. Round of applause for the Large Hadron Collider, because they actually invited me here, and that's who's doing everything. So this accelerates things until they're a few miles an hour short of the speed of light before smashing them into each other at the site of a vast detector. See the scale of this with this little fella? Well, he's not a little fella, he's a normal-sized fella. He's just in a big thing, you know. And those collisions recreate the energies right near the North Pole of the universe, where the entire universe was squeezed into a volume about kind of that big. Give or take 10 orders of magnitude, that's about that big to a physicist. So what is this thing? So you guys won't remember this, but on the day they turned this experiment on, only the older ones amongst you will remember. Do you remember they kind of said, oh, don't bother going to work or school today. The world's going to end. Do you remember that? Wasn't that weird? You see, out of all the millions of physicists in the world, not one of them said it would be dangerous. The only person who said it would be dangerous was a retired chemist. So that's what the media do, right? You've got a million experts on one end of the seesaw, one nincompoop on the other end, and they move the pivot so it seems balanced. Isn't that weird? But at least it was on the front pages, particle physics on the front page, which is brilliant. So that photo was on the front page of the Telegraph and the Times. Not every newspaper, sadly. On one of the most momentous days of human history, the Daily Mirror's headline was, Woman Has Haircut. Bit of a shame. And then a few years later, it finally found what it was looking for, this experiment, and that was the biggest announcement everywhere in the world that day as well. Everywhere except America, which again, for some reason, chose that day to announce that there's no evidence of mermaids. Do you really need your government to tell you that? So, what is this thing looking for? It's trying to understand this stuff called matter, right? So in school, you get told about matter. I always thought what you get told in school actually raises more questions than it answers, yeah? So in school, you get shown something like that. You're told it's an atom from the Greek word meaning indivisible. You can't subdivide it any further. But then you're told, actually, yes, you can. Subdivide it into electrons which orbit a nucleus of protons and neutrons. You're even told that the neutrons themselves can further subdivide in the process of radioactive decay. Incidentally, that's caused by something called the weak force. You've heard of the force of gravity, right? Have you heard of the electromagnetic force? Opposites attract, like charges repel. This is a third one for you, the weak force. So atoms clearly aren't quite as indivisible as their name implies. Secondly, even the very idea of atoms seems kind of inconsistent. At school, I put my hand up and said, Miss, if opposites attract, why don't the electrons just stick to the nucleus? And if like charges repel, why don't the protons just fly apart? And the answer I got was this. Shut up, they just don't. So I basically had to do a physics degree to get the answer to a simple question. Right? And the answer is this. Firstly, electrons are just weird. I'm not joking. They only exist at certain energy levels, none of which are in the nucleus, and they don't move between energy levels. They kind of teleport instantly when you look at them. I'm not joking. Secondly, the reason the protons don't fly apart is because their mutual repulsion is overcome by a very short-range attractive force called the strong force. So that's a fourth one for you. You've got gravity, electromagnetic, weak, and now strong. And the particles that feel the strong force are called hadrons, hence the name Large Hadron Collider. Careful how you spell hadron, by the way. Now, we think we understand how three of these forces fit together, the electromagnetic, the weak, and the strong. But because it's science, what we have to do is experimentally observe what the theory predicts against all odds, right? What the theory predicted was something called a Higgs field. A Higgs field is the reason why heavy things, like bricks, things like bricks interact with the Higgs field strongly. They've got a high mass. They're very massive. Light. Photons of light are massless. They don't interact with the Higgs field at all. And then other things that seemed like they should interact with the Higgs field and be massive are actually found to be surprisingly light. Look out! Chuck it back, thanks. I was hoping for a bit of a shriek. So you want to see how well that goes down in a girl's school, right? Just like a blast wave of screaming. So how do we find this field? In physics, if you're looking for a field, you look for the excitations of the field, the particles associated with the field. In this case, it's called a Higgs boson, and it had a characteristic collision signature that looked kind of like that. But that was hidden within literally billions of other paths. So it was real needle in a haystack job. It took years before we could confidently say that it wasn't just a random noisy event. It actually was a discovery. That's how long it takes to get a proper confident scientific discovery. Named after a guy called Peter Higgs, who was one of my lecturers at Edinburgh University. That's weird when the universe gets named after one of your teachers. Also called the God Particle. Not quite sure why. Peter doesn't look much like God, really, does he? So that's matter, right? As well as matter, if you went to Roger's talk, we're hoping to learn more about something called antimatter. Now, so you remember I said electrons? They're matter. There's such a thing as an anti-electron or positron, and they're really weird, right? You see, when a positron meets an electron, the two annihilate in a process we don't fully understand to give nothing but energy. I realized that wasn't very impressive. Yes, it's in me pocket. In fact, you can see it sticking out now. Right, this is better. Promise, this is much better. Weirder still, sometimes you start with nothing but energy, and suddenly a pair of particles pops into existence from nowhere. You can clap if you like. So I'm going to finish with my little finale, which I hope you'll like, which might need me to... oh, she's gone. Where's she gone? Oh, go on then. So, all right, so I do a famous song with my own lyrics on the screen, okay, which I hope you like quite a lot. Right, brilliant. Okay. Right, don't blame me. That's a real sign in Scotland. I thought I'd make a good... just one more.
One more?
Not yet. Right. No, okay, turn it on. Just run it. Press one more on, and then I'll say go. Right. One more on. Right, stop. I'll say go. Ah, no. Back again. Just use the cursors. Brilliant, right. Only press right when I say go. Stop. One more on. Press the button once. Press right cursor. What? Stop. Brilliant. Okay. Right. So this is a famous song that I do my own lyrics. That's not a spelling mistake. David Bohm is a famous quantum physicist. I realize we are actually in Bohemia now. So sorry about that. Now, you're not going to get all the jokes. You probably need a master's to get the jokes. Don't worry about it. Anyone with a master's, laugh along. But you, the audience, has two duties, right? In the middle, you've all got to nod your head in time, right? You'll know the bit. At the end, you've all got to make the sound of a gong, right? Everyone make the sound, when I go like this, everyone make the sound of a gong. Ready? Don't just say the word gong in a deep voice. If I said make the sound of a glockenspiel, you wouldn't go glockenspiel. All right, everyone go like this. Yes, you can still say gong if you want. All right. Okay, we ready? Ready for this? Okay. Let's go. Okay with that, yeah.
Thank you.
That's actually true. Thanks very much.